How's it going, everybody? We decided to get together, have a little discussion here about our fun Destiny event at E3. It was pretty crazy stuff. A lot of fun times happened, and I'm here with my two friends. We'll start with Drifter. Introduce yourself, sir.
Hey guys, Drifter here. You probably know me from Call of Duty videos, gun guides, or maybe a few more philosophical things. If not, that's totally okay. I'm just a gamer that likes to make guides, and I'll pass it off to David.
That was too
Sure.
perfect. That was too rehearsed.
That was good. I don't
That
have a nice intro, like a nice YouTube intro rehearsed, so I'm just gonna say, my name is David. I on Twitter I'm Mr. underscore Veselka, and I run mpfirst.com. We're a multiplayer centric news website where we focus primarily our content is primarily focused on multiplayer shooters, specifically first person shooters like Call of Duty, Battlefield, Halo. And yeah, we get really detailed into small little things. Like if there's a little update about a little gun tweak that happened over the weekend, we'll report on that. So yeah, it's we're trying to become one of the top destinations for multiplayer first person shooter gaming coverage.
Yeah, you're like the source for every sort of like, hey guys, check this out. I got this super legit top secret Call of Duty information. It's just like a link to your site. Yeah, he's got it covered. So there's actually gonna be two versions of this video. Drift is gonna upload a version, and I'm gonna have my own version. So they're probably gonna be slightly different in terms of video content, because I'm gonna be throwing some pictures and some gameplay in there. So right now, if you're on my channel, you're seeing some Destiny gameplay footage that I took at this Destiny event that we're about to talk about. And Drift, it's up to
I'll
him,
be
but
doing the same thing, man. Like
cool.
I didn't get the opportunity to film a whole lot in there other than the footage. I took a few pictures, but that was about it 'cause they were kind of strict on what you could and couldn't point
Yeah.
cameras at. And I always take my camera to these events like I'm going to be a one-man film crew or I'm going to get that one awesome moment, and I never film anything because the lighting is bad. I can't get somebody to hold the camera. It's not worth doing. Or everybody that runs the events thinks it's awesome to have some sort of music going. So when you try to hear the
Oh
audio, it's
yeah.
just like poof, doof, poof, poof. It's really loud.
My big thing is I'm the same thing. I actually brought multiple cameras with me. Like I had a backpack full of gear, and I'm going to all these cool events. I'm like, man, people would love to see me vlogging around here and stuff. But I always find I get caught up with talking to people. We're talking to friends, talking to you guys, talking to some of the devs. Like for instance, I always played with my headphones around my neck, just so I could talk and hear what they had to say about stuff. 'Cause I'm so much more interested in that.
Oh yeah, they were always stopping by with something to say.
Something cool. I guess worth mentioning for Drifter's channel, I run ReadyUpLive, youtube.com/ReadyUpLive, and I do mainly Halo stuff. Definitely big in the Destiny community too, big in the Bungie community. I've always been interested in that scene, a lot of friends in that group. So yeah, if you're down especially for Halo stuff, that's what
I
I
get a
do. I
feeling
do.
you're gonna be the guy that's like playing Destiny all wrong, like LARPing. Like when we got there, we got this
Yeah.
big long speech about you can play Destiny any way you want. You can create your own character, have your own story. So all of us, we did the campaign, we made our character. A few people just jumped straight into multiplayer. I look over at Dan, and he's in the tower, which is like where you go to trade and like meet people and talk with him, and he's dancing and he's humping a guy and he's jumping around and then he's playing volleyball. I don't think I saw you actually play the first person shooting part of Destiny once. You spent no less than 2 hours just goofing around in the tower.
Okay, so I guess we'll get into that. Might as well start from the top. Now that
Sure.
the discussion's beginning. So we started. We're all there for on behalf of Activision. And which is pretty cool. We were told to meet in our hotel lobby at a certain time. So I come down, and I thought when I came down, I was the only one there. I thought I was gonna go meet with other people or something. And I saw our Activision buddy who I knew, and I was like, oh, how's it going, man? Nice to meet you in person, whatever. And then I'm looking around. I'm like, there's no one else standing up. Is there anyone else here? Is it just me? I'm not sure. And then he says, I'll introduce you to the other guys in a minute here. And he points to like a big group of guys sitting. I'm like, oh, okay, cool. And then slowly later, like we found out that there was another group behind them, which were you guys, still sitting there too. So I just kind of went around, did my rounds, introduced myself to people, and I was pretty surprised to find out how many like Call of Duty guys there were.
Yep,
Because
there were a
it's,
lot.
it's I don't
There's
know, it's
no established
yeah,
Destiny people, or
exactly.
not a lot of them. And also the Halo community, when it comes to YouTube and social media, is comparatively small to Call of Duty. So like
Yeah,
every
definitely.
game company brings out the Call of Duty guys to play their game. Like even EA with Battlefield and stuff, they specifically targeted the Call of Duty audience, so they'd bring out the COD players. But if you're looking for people at an event, like other YouTubers and gamers, the Dead giveaway
is Astro Backpack. Astro Backpack,
I know.
Filled full of crap, that's going to be a YouTuber, guaranteed.
Yeah, no, I totally talked about that too, and I saw everyone standing there with the same Astro. But I liked it. It was a really, really cool scene, especially for someone like me that it's, you know, I wish there's a bigger audience for the kind of stuff I did, because, you know, everyone wishes that, right? But it's always cool to meet different guys and see, honestly, even how they act, even how they are around other people, because I have noticed, actually, a difference among games that people play and the type of person they are. Oddly enough, it's pretty interesting. Really fun meeting you guys. So that was cool. So we started in this lobby, and we all made friends, and then we went to this big bus, which was way bigger than we needed. There really weren't many of us, right? There were, what, like 10 of us or something?
I think like it was something like they invited a bunch of people that were local. So the locals drove themselves, and then they also had some people just kind of sketch out on them for no particular reason. So the bus was supposed to seat like 30 or 40, and there might have been 10 of us.
And then, yeah, so we were on this bus with only like 10 of us, and we're like, okay, you know, we're all discussing, we don't know how many people are going to be at this event. I only assumed from the beginning, before I even knew there were like Call of Duty guys coming, I thought it was going to be like tight-knit Bungie community guys, that there's going to be like 10 of us at this little tiny thing. I had no idea that we were going to show up from this bus ride to a huge, like, tower. What was it? I forget wherever we were.
Yeah, was that the AT&T tower,
yeah.
I think?
Yeah, the AT&T tower.
We were on the top floor.
We were on the penthouse level, man. Penthouse, like, where all of the windows around us were glass. It's like where a movie villain would sit there and just lord over the city looking out his glass windows and stuff.
Yeah.
I got told it was going to be a moderate-sized event, you know, like it would be something, there would be some people there, but I had no idea it was going to be as big as it was. When I showed up, it was like everybody and their grandmother was there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they Huge. Split us off into two rooms, I believe, right? I think they had the European guys over on one side and then the North American guys over on the other.
Yeah, which was weird.
But they also
split
it based on who had capture cards and not. Like, if you brought your own equipment, they had your own equipment stations, but then all the other stations were set up with laptops and Elgatos and everything just good to go.
Right.
And like, hey, did you bring a flash drive? Awesome, you're good to record.
So we go up the elevator, and I'm pretty sure we were one of the first groups to go up, if not the first, right? Like, we were pretty early.
Yeah, but everything was branded. You forget, you go to the lobby of the AT&T Center, giant Destiny sign, like 20 people wearing Destiny gear, devs and like studio people and security. You walk in, like, Destiny posters everywhere, Destiny this way, Destiny elevator. You go upstairs, the floor has the giant Destiny symbol like sprayed on it, and just everything. What was like the yellow hallway? They put up these weird yellow lights by the fan that spun.
So you felt like
you were in the level.
Fan there. I have a picture of that actually, right, which is cool. Massive fan, obviously emulating that one of the first gameplay trailers we saw of Destiny, where there's the guy with the shotgun rock through the hallway, and there's like a huge, huge fan in there.
Oh,
right, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's supposed to feel like the level, and they're telling us you can't tweet pictures of this and you can't tweet pictures of that, but tweet pictures of the fan. Just make sure you get our sweet fan in this
thing. You know, the Destiny's biggest fan jokes flew everywhere, right? Like, just all over the place. Oh, I'm but a big fan, right? But we actually got asked for my ID like 3 times by 3 different people that night. They kept going. Like, everyone's like, are you sure you're 21? I'm like, yes.
That's because of the, they have to, because they have two open bars. They had two open bars.
Yeah.
Now they served, it was water and sodas, but they also had just about any kind of liquor or beer or whatever
Good
that you
stuff.
Wanted. Totally free. Yeah.
Yeah.
But they had nobody under 18, under 21, did they?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
They must have, because the guy downstairs, who the second dude to like try to check me again, even though like he saw the girl check my ID, he wanted to look himself, and he almost slapped me with like it's like a white wristband.
You can't trust Canadians, man.
Yeah, so I didn't see.
Oh yeah,
we got the
drinking and non-drinking wristbands. I remember.
Yeah,
because they can't have a party and not have a way to keep track of the minors, because it's illegal here to serve alcohol to minors, so they had to have kind of going on.
Everywhere, probably. we go up this elevator, and, you know, we have no idea what to expect. Obviously, we're already ready for a ton of people since the lobby was just filled, and it was surreal. Like, I wish, this is the one part I wish I vlogged. I wish I had my camera going. I wish I had a GoPro strapped to me, where we walk up, and there's just this hallway. There's like swag on the side, like all this merch, like t-shirts and stuff.
Wait,
but
there was swag?
Yeah, man,
there was
a bunch of t-shirts.
What?
Yeah.
Oh man.
I got that Destiny like light cotton fleecy kind of shirt.
They're really comfortable, but they're the same ones
Damn.
You can get everywhere.
No,
like,
I got none of that. I was really overwhelmed by the waitresses and the servers.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So we walk up this hallway, this huge fan at the end, all these cool lights glowing on us, right? And there is it's like a movie where
each room had a different color. They had the red and the blue and all that kind of stuff going on.
Yeah, oh yeah, that too.
Oh, and black lights.
Like, yeah, these waitresses and waiter stuff were just standing there at our ready for us to walk through. Like, it was a hallway of waitress and, like, you know, like they were ready, and they had these plates on them, and they were just all holding, you know, glasses of wine, chocolates, beer, like Heineken and Stella were the main ones.
They
like
also had they had mini grilled cheese and peanut butter and jellies. I mean, like thumb size, but it was some sort of organic, super high quality something. And then they had fries that came in kind of the cones looked like it'd be like a water cooler cone, but it was like a little thing of like spicy fries and just, you know, finger foods. But they also had, I found this out when it was too late, they had medium rare buttered steak cut into strips about half the size of your pinky finger and on these little mini
with
forks.
Cheese on them.
Yeah, so you could just eat like one bite of steak at a time.
Yeah, it was incredible. That was probably my favorite food. But they were also coming around with these trays of brownies or truffles or whatever they were. But they literally had liquid edible gold on them.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't liquid edible gold. It was edible gold flakes inside. Yeah. They had liquid chocolate, and they were like a mousse kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, very, very rich food. And they also had little cheesecakes that were loaded down with actual fruit. I don't mean like frozen stuff. I mean like actual hand-sliced strawberries and blackberries and stuff. But for some reason, all of the real food went to the other side where the Europeans were.
Yeah.
And all of the junk food came to our side. So the waitress would come by and be like, hey, do you want another 4 or 5 chocolate mousse and some cheesecake? I'm like, no. And they're like, sure you do. Take some more.
Yeah, yeah, well, especially with those little mousse things, they started on little plates, and they kept coming, and bigger plates, and I'm like, I can't, I mean, there's like shiny gold, I thought it was a wrapper at first, that like gold topping to it. And I was like, oh, I should try to peel this off, and it like melted in my finger. I'm like, what? And then they kept coming. I'm like, no, please stop.
They got Cross worse than anybody, because Cross, I mean, I got a sweet tooth, but Cross just kept getting more and more. He must have had 8 or 10 of those little mousses, and I don't even know how many cheesecakes he had.
Even the fries too, those would come around. I was like,
I didn't get any of those. I got the whole time I was there, I got nothing but sweets and no real food at all, and I just kept playing.
Regarding the like European US side, I don't know if that was actually very intentional, because I talked to some people afterwards, and some of them, I don't know, some people didn't think it was really meant to be that way, but somehow, like, as soon as you entered this, you saw this fan. To the right of the fan was like one room, left of the fan another room, and the right side apparently was pretty much all European press. And left side was like all of us, all the North American dudes. And I don't know what the purpose of that was or why or anything.
It was people that brought their own capture. So the rooms were almost identical. They had, I would say, maybe 40 32-inch TVs on each side and like this kind of bar stool, and you'd sit down. And then you had a glass desk in front of you. It was a Turtle Beach spot, a capture card spot, and then a laptop spot. And you had a free-hanging HDMI cable, and I've never seen this before. Usually you go to an event, and you kind of have to unplug the HDMIs from the TV and set up your own capture card and whatever. This one had everything already passing through some kind of splitter, so all I had to do was plug the HDMI straight into my capture card, and it was good to go and awesome. And I had my laptop stand and my food stand, my Turtle Beach stand and my everything stand right there in front of me. PlayStation 4 was set up and good to go, and it was running off a retail PlayStation 4, not a dev kit, not a PC, but they just like went to Walmart and bought a bunch of regular old PS4s or something and hooked them up. It was probably the best setup I've ever done. I've been to quite a few events, and you're usually having to do something complicated to get your capture card to work. You usually have to ask for help, or you usually have to unplug a bunch of stuff. They had it good to go. They even had a power strip on the wall for like any device you wanted to plug in. Each station had 12 plugs, so it was really fancy. The other side was identical, except they had the laptops and Elgatos and stuff already hooked up, so they were already recording over there. All they needed to do was bring a flash drive, and for whatever reason, I think it may be like all the Europeans were traveling light. They didn't bring any of that, so they just went over there and just moved to flash drives.
Yeah, maybe.
I was told before I went to bring all of my own recording gear, so when I got there, I went to the record your own session.
Yep.
It was kind of cool because they had all the developers there. Like every single, not all of them, Bungie's a huge studio, but they had no less than 50 or 60 devs there, and studio heads, a marketing team, PR, a graphic artist, concept artist, character artist. One guy was actually the story guy that designed the story for the game behind all the characters and just tons and tons of people. But they also had a whole ton of people at home. Like, every Bungie employee was at home playing at the same time, and they'd already leveled up to max, which was lovely. But we thought we were going to play on, like, a local LAN and do, like, alpha LAN, which is not uncommon because it doesn't lag. Nope. We got on our PlayStations, we connected our PlayStations directly to the internet, and then played with all the Bungie people from home, all on retail, everything. So we were getting the real in-game lag experience. Mind you that, like, nobody was playing outside of maybe a 30-mile geographical area.
Yeah, I actually ran into zero problems with that, but I did notice I ran into a lot of TTL guys, so that's like Deej's infamous clan. So every time he stopped by, I'd be like, I'm like, oh, do you know like this TTL guy or whatever? And I was dancing with a lot of them. You know, they knew what was up, which was really cool.
Oh, yeah, Deej was there talking to everybody.
Yeah, Deej is really cool. This is going back to the developers thing. There's a perfect reason why I always say that I'd so much rather just have my headphones around my neck, because people will come up to me and talk to me for like just devs and stuff. Like, I had the character designer come up to me and talk to me for like an hour. Everything I saw, he'd give me tips. He's like, all right, so here's how this mission was designed. He would tell me like steps through it that no one would have thought of before, and he would explain designing some of the character stuff, and these little tidbits made it so much more worth it and so much of a different experience than just immersing myself and just playing, because I'm like, I'll get to do that eventually. I'd so much rather hear it, you know, from the guys who made it. So it's a pretty cool experience.
I think developers just any chance that they can get to like speak to non-traditional press. Like, I guess I'm kind of traditional press. I'm sort of in the middle, but
not way. Yeah, you're not traditional.
Yeah, but everybody else, right? They're just fans of the game, and so any chance that these devs can get to just like talk about the game with somebody who likes, you know, who they know likes their game, and they don't really have to worry about like giving away secrets and stuff. They'll probably just, you know, they'll go off and just talk about their game, which is, it's nice to see.
Well, another pro of the being the you know, non-conventional press is that they're, you know, they will find those fans that they could probably talk to for a while and stuff, and the fans be really excited and stuff. But we are that perfect middle ground where, you know, if we're there, a lot of us, there's a lot of big YouTubers there and stuff, a lot of people like that. They're like, yeah, we know what we're talking about. We understand game design, you know, like a lot of that kind of stuff. So he's actually can talk to us like we're on his level, and yet we'd still be excited about it. Where there's all those different layers there, right? Where you talk to a press guy, it would be like almost entirely like, you know, very professional, like, oh, I'm taking notes on what we're doing here. And then the fans, they just be like, oh, that's really cool, but they might not necessarily fully understand what they're talking about, kind of thing. So we're that middle ground.
Yeah. Veselka was at that for the Titanfall. They did two sessions. They did one just for press, and the gameplay was terrible. And then they had one, like, the YouTubers come, and all the devs were really happy. They're like, they're double jumping. They're wall running. The gameplay is really good. I'm liking it. It's like, we never thought anybody would jump off this such an angle and do that thing. Yeah. But they also had that problem once at the original Call of Duty Championships for Black Ops 2. They invited almost only press and media, and there were like no public passes. So for the first 2 days, it was just a bunch of press guys sitting there watching, and there was almost no cheering at all, which was really awkward. And it wasn't until like the last day and things got serious that everybody kind of came up and crowded the stage and cheered and stuff. So they did it differently this year with like a lot more public. But the press guys, they're going to go to every press. Well, you did this. You went to every single briefing and meeting and everything, and you're just like, what is innovative about your game? You know, they don't care.
Yeah,
but it was nice because when they did the Titanfall thing, you know, I was in the room filled with press, so I was getting great gameplay.
Oh yeah, you're murdering everybody.
Because you know, I'm the guy who only plays first-person shooters. So, meanwhile, you have, you know, the guy next to me is like, he's an RPG buff or something.
Yeah, no, it's really nice seeing this change in the industry, and that's why I'm really confident for the three of us, for other YouTubers listening in on this, that like times are really changing and companies are really taking notice of YouTubers and realizing the outlet that is there, that we are really, really important for game franchises to keep communities growing and thriving. So it's
now
really
you're
nice
making
to
me
see
feel all warm and fuzzy inside.
I hope so, man.
Yeah,
so it's exciting times coming.
Yeah, I sort of started MP First as like a way to sort of get into that YouTube scene without doing YouTube, because you know, I didn't have the equipment or anything like that. But,
Well, I mean, it says a lot that you're on this podcast / video / whatever we're doing right here, right now.
Oh yes.
Right. Like awesome. You're doing it, right? But, like,
I've made it.
You don't need And that's,
I'm
you know,
on Reddit
so,
Live.
Yeah, to everyone else out there too. Right? But like, you know, even if YouTube isn't your thing, there's always a way to break
there,
in, to
like...
be able to get invented to things, get invited to events like this.
Do you have any idea how many people use the images and info for your site and just quote it or link it or share it, or sometimes they just rip it off or just re-upload, like, all over
that,
the place?
Happens. Yeah. Yeah. I get the pingbacks.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. So I'm trying to think if there's any other big things that happened. That was pretty much it. Like, it was, I just realized we didn't even really talk about Destiny. We had a great time.
Destiny is kind of odd because it worries me. It might be overly ambitious. It's trying to do so many things at once. You've got these elements of like kind of like a Borderlands or maybe like this open world multiplayer explore, do your own level thing. It's kind of gear centric, but then there's supposed to be a big story component where you play your story, yet you're playing with other people. I actually hopped in the middle of some like random side quest. I've never been able to do it again while I was at the event. Then you go to the tower, and the tower is, it's basically the Citadel from Mass Effect, but maybe with like some Knights of the Old Republic in there, because there's other people running around, like some World of Warcraft kind of stuff. Like, you can trade with people. I don't think they had that in the alpha, but I know it's coming. You can do the things at the shops, you can talk, you can dance, party up, all sorts of stuff. But then when all that is done, we're moving over to multiplayer, which, as much as I'm sure they hate to hear it, plays a lot like Halo, and they're trying to do their own like competitive sort of multiplayer things, and I'm sure that's just a fraction of what all they're putting into the game. So it's got so many different components, which worries me if they don't, sometimes you can lose your focus and you can have three different components and they be three bad components, whereas you could do just like one really good component. I mean, I hope it's successful, but it's really, really ambitious.
Yeah, that's, I mean, it's really hard to describe it with another word than ambitious. Personally, I had a great time with it. I really, really enjoyed it, but I do think that there is that crowd that are not really going to be particular fans of it. I'll say that in terms of single player, if you are a fan of Borderlands, this is like your ultimate game.
This is
Space
Borderlands.
I was so happy because I'm a huge Borderlands fan, and I always knew that Destiny was very going to be, you know, Borderlands-esque, but I was very pleasantly surprised to feel that it felt that way. Like, really felt like Borderlands, which I
like.
Even
when you shoot people, the damage numbers pop
up. Yeah, the damage numbers pop up. Yeah, I like that. I'm a big fan of that, but, you know, that's not for everybody. That's definitely not for everybody.
Yeah, I really like the... I tweeted this to DJ, actually. What was really refreshing about the whole thing was just to see a first-person shooter out there with that sort of well-known Bungie stamp of approval, or that like Bungie level of quality, if you know what I mean. And it kind of extends to the multiplayer. Like, a lot of developers out there, you know, they're trying to sort of either copy, like almost downright copy the Call of Duty formula, or somehow inject some of it into their game. And it ends
even Halo's a little bit notorious for that lately, so,
Yeah, but, you know, I think with Destiny and Bungie, these guys were like, you know, no, let's do some of these Call of Duty things. Like, they have aim down sight, the map layout, not only the layout, but the game mode was very Call of Duty-like, which, for me, and Drifter
well,
as
no,
well, like...
Well, the small map was, the big map was not.
True, that's true. That was a very Halo map. Yeah, you're right on that. I just like how they took these sort of Call of Duty elements that, you know, guys like me and Drifter can appreciate because we play that game a lot. And, you know, they did it really well. And they did it with a certain level of quality, and it's also, it still felt fresh. It was just like, you know, I could just start playing, and I literally, what came to my head was just like this, feeling.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
this is nice.
It was good. It was casual, but casual in a good way. Like, if I got stomped on multiplayer for a little bit, I was like, you know what? Screw it. I'm going to go play the single player for a little bit and see if I can find some better gear.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And that's really what they're aiming for, I think, too, right? That really, really solid crossover, right? That it's you play some multiplayer, you play some single player, you play this, you play that. And I think we're going to see a lot more of that moving forward. I mean, Watch Dogs, I think, did a pretty great job of combining single player and multiplayer and just like jump in and out and like combining them, like little events that'll happen that are multiplayer focused. So like a lot of games are going to start incorporating that. And I think Destiny really does a good job of it. And I can say that some people at this event played only competitive multiplayer the whole night,
which
essentially.
Was sad.
I wish they got to see more, but at the same time, they were all raving about it.
This coming from the guy that spent 2 hours kicking a ball around.
That's how you play, man.
The way I understand it, though, is this what you guys got as well? That you, when every time you enter an area, you're technically you're match made into like a game.
Yes.
Of
kind of.
They didn't really say how many players. I tried to ask, but they didn't. They said they're still.
It was usually like I saw usually like 3 or 4 in the single player world, and sometimes you could do the mission with them. Sometimes they would be on the same map but doing a side quest, and it was kind of different. But I've played at home, and I usually got matched with 3 other people.
Okay, so they were like, oh, was it always no more than 3 people in your game world?
At home, I don't remember there ever being more than 3. At the event was a lot more chaotic, and I was running on a lot less sleep, so it was hard to tell.
That's interesting. Yeah, I never got the chance to play the first look alpha from my home. I only have an Xbox One.
So we're on the same level here, man. I was like,
My PS4 collected dust for almost 6 months because there were no games that I wanted to play on it. And then I just played the ever-living crap out of the Destiny Alpha and a little bit of the Battlefield Hardline Beta. And I went to turn my Xbox on, and it wasn't doing it. It's like, oh, I got to swap the HDMI cables. It's been so long.
Yeah. No, it's so overall impressions. I think we've run on a while now. What do you guys think? The event, we all agree, was like one of the best things I've ever been to.
It was really nice. They threw down some serious budget for that catering and planning and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, it was super well done. So, you know, big shout out, as always, to Bungie and Activision for allowing this dream to happen, because it was incredible. Mm-hmm. And overall impressions of the game. It's final thoughts here, guys.
Yeah.
So far, at least.
I think Bungie should be proud that it feels like Halo, to be honest. Like, because it's a good game. And I really liked the single-player combat was very satisfying, which it also reminded me very much of Halo. I really like Halo's single-player combat and the way their enemy types sort of work together against you. I mean, the enemies by themselves weren't all that powerful or too challenging, but, you know, I think, Drift, you said in one of your videos, too, like, you died a lot. I died a lot. I went on the first mission by myself, and the last guy just, he took me out multiple times.
Were you guys not Titans?
I was a hunter.
Yeah, I ran in as Titan first, and I just cleaned up. And then, I played it like Halo. Titan plays like Halo, and then I played the others, and I was just dying. I'm like,
I had to be a little more careful as my hunter. What happened was not everybody kind of knew what they were doing, and I was jumping ahead in level. So in multiplayer, everything scales and makes it fair. In single player, if you are a low level or if you don't have good gear, there is no scaling or making it fair. So I rolled into some of the more advanced levels, and I got smashed really bad.
There was actually one of my favorite moments for the night. Was when the character designer was watching me play, he was giving me suggestions on where to go. He's like, check this place out. There's a little like hidden cave here.
You should
here.
Kick that ball over there.
Yeah, no, honestly, yeah. They were telling me where the balls were and all that kind of stuff. And then so I went into this little cave, and at the back of it were 3 like question mark level guys. Like guys that were just so powerful. They were just like normal characters, but they had such they're like fallen, stupid high levels, and they're just hiding in the back of this random cave in the middle of nowhere. And I'm like, that's what I like to see though. Like that's my favorite kind of gameplay. I'm just like, hey, is there something in this cave? Yes, guys that will just mess you up, right? Like, and I just got destroyed. I just ran out of that cave like a pansy, and I'm like, that's cool, though. I want to see more of that kind of thing.
Yeah. I based my character off of... I'm a huge Mass Effect fan, by the way. Nobody knows. Like, just a huge
You should
fan.
Be.
So I based my character off a Mass Effect Asari, so I created, like, the blue female warlock, and I love the Nova Bomb because... It pretty much does the same thing like the push biotic move in Mass Effect. So you just throw the bomb, right? And when it kills the enemies, they're kind of like coated in this blue shiny coating or whatever, and they sort of float off. And so I don't know, that was cool. It reminded me of Mass Effect, but I don't know. I really like the Warlock, and I think I actually might stick. No, the beta when the beta comes out, I'll do the Titan and the Hunter. But I have the feeling that when the game comes out, I'm going to stick with a Warlock.
I'm sticking with Hunter. I look further in the tree. You know you can upgrade the Hunter to have a triple jump?
Wicked!
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's and useful. Also you can upgrade it toward the gold gun, the solar gun. You shoot somebody and they explode and do damage to the enemies around them.
That's
and
really
you can
solid.
Do it toward, like, every time you kill somebody, it lasts longer and you get, like, 1 bullet per kill. So, yeah.
Wow. I really liked Titan's hover ability because everyone has a little bit of a double jump hover kind of thing, but Titan literally, like, hovers. So I was fighting the Hive and they were just in swarms underneath me and I was just floating above their heads, firing down with my shotgun and just not getting touched, and it was awesome.
Oh, yeah. Titan always ice also slams in. I would just hear this, and then just get smashed.
Yeah.
What did the hunter do for a double jump? Because my warlock also like hovered. It didn't really double jump, but
I think hunter is the really really short double jump one.
Is it
like jump? Because there was one of them was pretty much only a double jump. One of them was a very minor hover, and then Titan was actually hovering like a jetpack.
No, Warlock hovers pretty good. Mine has this standard straightforward double jump, but I move faster than y'all clowns.
Cool. Well, yeah. I think that covers it. Some good thoughts. Because main purpose was just talking about the event, because it was really cool, and just some fun stuff came out of that. And really looking forward to playing the beta with you guys, hopefully. And anyone else, really. It's going to be some good times. So I guess to end this off, share up your YouTube channels.
YouTube.com/Drifter, DRIFT0R.
And in terms of Ahsoka, you're not YouTube channel.
We do have one. You can visit us at YouTube.com/MP1STTV. But no, the website is MP1ST.com, which if you don't know, it stands for MultiplayerFirst.com.
Cool.
And or on Twitter is at MPFIRST. The guy who has at MP1ST is not giving that up, so.
No, brutal. I guess I'm at Greenskull, and then Drifter is
just at Drifter. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. So yeah, follow us around, guys. Whether you're watching on Drift channel or my channel, welcome. Hopefully there's some cross sharing here. I hope you guys go check out his channel. You guys go check out David. Sharing is caring, everybody. Sharing is caring. So thanks for coming, guys. Thanks for joining. This was a lot of fun, and hopefully we're going to stay in touch and continue playing Destiny and other fun games in the near future.
Alrighty, will do. I'll catch you later.
Sounds good.
See you guys later.
Biological. Human. Not hostile.
Not you.
Listen, we don't have a lot of time. You're about to see some things you won't understand. Let's get you up to speed.